Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for that wonderful warm introduction and the wonderful welcome and the opportunity to speak with you today. I'm humbled for this opportunity. So how did I get here? A girl from Maple Valley, a former student of Mr. Oglesby. Why am I in Dallas, Texas speaking with all of you? Mr. O asked me if I would speak to his students. And I said, well, sure, I'll speak to your government class. And then he clarified, no, all of my students. And I had already said yes, so I couldn't back out at that point. So here I am. So how did I get from here? This is circa 1998 in front of the actual White House press room podium to here, December of 2016, at a table in a conference room with Vice President Biden. I will tell you how I got from here to here. The Dedman Lecture Series has an intimidating list of past speakers, from senators to professional football players. Well, I'm sorry to say that I'm too small for the NFL, and as a military spouse, I'm not in a consistent enough place to run a successful campaign yet, but maybe someday you can say you knew me when. I remember, I know this might be hard to believe, but I remember being in your seat. I remember that our guest speaker for my leadership seminar when I was a senior in high school was Brock Heward, who was the quarterback for the University of Washington at the time. I have no idea what he told us, but I guess it's probably something similar to a lot of leadership speeches. You know, there's no magic answers for success. There's a lot of known cliches: work hard, persevere, overcome challenges, prepare, prepare, prepare. You all know these. These are all common sense. You may have noticed that the title of my speech is a little bit strange, right? I'm not where I thought I would be. That doesn't really sound like success. It almost sounds like failure. You know, I set a lot of goals in my life, just like you will and have. I worked really hard to achieve those goals, and I didn't end up where I thought I would be. And that's okay, because I love where I am right now. I thought I would be doing something different than I'm doing right now, but I wouldn't have it any other way. So here's my not-so-secret secret to success. Change will happen. It's going to happen to all of us throughout your life. And how you deal with that change has a lot to do with this school's founding tenets. Smart people, your founders, to establish these great tenets to use to apply to your everyday life. So I'm going to talk about these tenets as they apply to my history and my past and share my life story with you in the hope that it will open your mind to realize that those tenets also apply to you in your life. And maybe, hopefully, you'll remember a thing or two that I say today. So here's back at the White House press room in 1998, where it all began. I think of my life in two chapters. I say BC and AC, before cancer and after cancer. You'll notice in your life that there are a lot of life-changing moments. Some are positive, the aha moments, and some are negative, which I call the aw shucks moments. I've had plenty of both, more aha moments than aw shucks moments, but I'm gonna share several of them with you. So my junior year of high school, I had a plan. I was definitely a planner, the oldest of two kids. I feel like oldest children are always type A to the extreme. I was planned my whole life out. I was gonna go to college close to home near Seattle because I was very close to my family. I was gonna study physical therapy. When I was 14, I blew out my ankle playing soccer, had to have reconstructive surgery, and physical therapy was a really big part in me getting ready for that varsity soccer season. So I decided that that's what I wanted to do, to help people rehab and meet their goals in life. So I was going to become a physical therapist using an ROTC scholarship. Both of my grandfathers were in the Navy, and I've always been drawn to military service, and that was something that I really wanted to do from a very young age. My family was supportive of my goals and really, really encouraged me to go for it. So I did. My junior year, I applied for ROTC. I had to designate a school that the scholarship would be awarded to, so I chose the University of Washington, close to home, great school, good medical program, great physical therapy school. I was all set. And then my senior year happened, and there was a minor change of plans because there was this guy. And I really, really, really liked him. And he was a football player, but he was too small at 255 pounds, too small to play Division I ball. So he started looking at other colleges, like one in San Diego called the University of San Diego, which you may recall that I am an alum of. And I knew that he couldn't be in Washington. He wanted to go to San Diego, so that's where I wanted to be. So I decided to follow him and my heart to San Diego. I had to try to figure out how I was going to get my scholarship that was awarded to the University of Washington, a public, cheaper school, to the University of San Diego, which was a private, not so cheap school. And I didn't know how I was going to do it, but I knew I would figure it out. And I did. So I committed to the University of San Diego the spring of my senior year, sacrificed a full ride scholarship to the University of Washington, didn't know at that time that I would get a full ride to the University of San Diego, but true love, right? I mean, Mr. Oglesby was just showing that we were the best couple in our senior year high school yearbook, so this was a real, real relationship, and it was worth the sacrifice to me. Side note, he's not my husband. the spring of my senior year, and Mr. O has a whole photo album right here of lovely pictures. I was fortunate enough to go to Washington, D.C. for We the People competition, which is a nationwide competition. It's essentially a constitutional debate competition. It was my first time to D.C., and I loved it. I loved the history. I loved the culture. It was just such an eye-opening experience for me. I had the opportunity to go on a private insider tour of the White House, so here I am, literally standing behind the press booth at the press room in the White House, which was pretty cool. It's been remodeled since then. It doesn't look that like that when Sean Spicer speaks, so this was a really long time ago. It kind of planted a seed for me, that trip, about getting interested in politics. I'd never really considered it before. You know, I was going to be a physical therapist. That was my plan. But being on this trip and seeing government in action and studying it and knowing it and being a part of it really, really planted a seed of political and civic interest to me. Then came college. So here I was in San Diego. Luckily, thanks to meeting some of our representatives and senators while we were in Washington, D.C., my scholarship did get changed. So I arrived at University of San Diego in the fall of 1998 with a full ride scholarship. These are, just to let you know, pictures of pictures, because when I started college, there were no digital cameras. So pardon the quality. These are my iPhone pictures of actual photographs. So I'm in San Diego. It's a Jesuit university. I'm not Catholic. I was raised Presbyterian. And I had a really hard time at first finding my place and fitting in. I struggled with finding community. I didn't really feel welcome at Mass on campus, and I didn't have a car my freshman year to get off campus. So I ended up getting involved with all of these wonderful people who were part of a non-denominational group at my school, and they became my community. I was far away from my family, a few thousand miles away from my family, and for the first time, really. And they became my family at school. So I wanted to share that picture of the importance of my college community. I also got to do some really cool things every summer when I was in ROTC. My last summer, in between my junior and senior year, I had decided that I wanted to fly helicopters. That's what I wanted to do when I got commissioned in the Navy. So I got to fly helicopters my senior year of college, which was really, really, really cool. This is me in Guam. I was attached to a search and rescue squadron at Anderson Air Force Base, and that's a CH-46 back there. They just retired those aircraft, so they don't fly them anymore, but I got to fly one, which was a really, really cool experience. Right after that, when I got back to school to start my senior year, I had come to the conclusion that my lovely high school boyfriend that I had followed to San Diego, cutest couple, remember, was not my soulmate and was not the person I saw myself with in the future. And I went through a really, really hard decision, really hard process. It took me a long time to come to this decision that I needed to end our relationship. And it was really, really a challenge for me, because being with him really kind of guaranteed me a wedding and 2.5 kids and a white picket fence and the dog and all that great stuff, home with my family because our parents were friends. But I, with the support of my community and my church, I was able to walk away from that, knowing, having faith that everything would work out okay. And it did. On the day of my graduation, I was commissioned as an ensign in the United States Navy. There's my two grandfathers who were there for my commissioning. I was really, really grateful that both of them could be there. They helped pin on my shoulder boards, which was a really cool experience. And then I got to my ship. Ta-da. This is a guided missile cruiser. It's still homeported out of Norfolk, Virginia. It's 565 feet long. At the time, there was a crew of 400 people, and I was the fourth female. I walked on board in my whites with my set of orders in my hands, and I told the gentleman on the quarterdeck, BM2 Christchurch, I still remember his name. It's important to remember people's names. I told BM2 Christchurch that I was there checking in for a tour, and he said, a tour of the ship? And I said, no, a tour of duty. This is my new duty station. Talk about change. To go from college life, you know, we're surrounded by men and women, to this, where I lived essentially for 2.5 years. And I was the only female in the entire weapons department. I was assigned the ordnance officer. I'm from Seattle, was raised by very pacifist parents, had never shot a gun in my life until I joined ROTC. And now I was in charge of every round of ammunition on a multi-billion-dollar warship. So it's a pretty incredible responsibility. I was also in charge of 21 men. and it was a challenge to determine our relationship. You know, I was their leader, whether they liked it or not, and how I dealt with them and how I dealt with issues regarding them, I knew would make a big difference. I learned a lot in those 3 years, as you could probably imagine. The biggest thing that I learned was my leadership style. I established a leadership style of servant leadership. There were plenty of examples of leaders on our ship, I call it command leadership, where, you know, you do what I say. That's very common in the military. It's really our military doctrine, the, you know, the officer orders the enlisted around, but that wasn't necessarily how I wanted to approach my team. This is an operation from the Red Sea. The two pictures on the left are an actual Tomahawk launch into Iraq from the Red Sea, and then there's a picture of the Tomahawk launching at night. When you're in those situations, having the respect of the people that are launching these weapons and needing to make sure that they arrive exactly where they're supposed to arrive because lives are at stake and it matters, you need those people to respect you and to listen to you. And in order to do that, there has to be a mutual relationship of respect. And I found that the best way to build that was by practicing servant leadership. Whites and blues in my uniform. So a little bit about servant leadership. How can I help you? It's not the boss in the back commanding his team, you know, what can you do for me? But what can I, as a leader, do for you to help you accomplish the job, the mission in the Navy? You know, in the military, it's all about accomplishing the mission. How can I help you so that we can accomplish this mission successfully together? That's the approach that I took as an officer in the Navy, and that's the approach I take now as a director with a couple people on my team, but managing large accounts and dealing with relationships all the time. I found it really interesting when I was preparing for this that I learned that building community is actually one of the 10 most important characteristics of servant leadership. You know, we talk about community as a founding tenet of this school, and community is really important. I have depended on my community throughout my life, and I thought that that was a really that was something that was really eye-opening to me, was that it's so important that it's one of the tenets of servant leadership, and I've definitely embraced that and practiced that in my life. So I'm going to tell you a little story about ethical decision-making. When you're an officer in the Navy, you know, there's this hierarchy of respect, and typically the people who are above you, you nod your head and smile and say, yes, sir, no, sir. So I was leaving my first ship, and I had my checkout with my executive officer. He's the second in command of the ship, several ranks above me. And he asked me what my future plans in the Navy were. And I had to make a decision. Do I be honest and tell him, this was a really negative experience this past 3 years. Because of this negative experience, I plan to serve my commitment and then get out. Or do I nod my head, smile, and say, this has been wonderful. Thank you very much for a great tour. Have a nice day, sir. Knowing that the first answer was the right answer, but it might get me in a little bit of trouble. I chose the first answer anyway. I thought at that point, kind of, you know, I'm leaving the ship. What do I have to lose? So I told him that. And his response to me was, well, I'm glad you're getting out. That's good. You should find a profession where your kindness is appreciated. And I swallowed, and I replied back to him, I was raised with the expectation that kindness is a virtue. It's not a negative quality, it's a virtue. Why can't we be kind leaders? Why can't you know, I've spent 3 years getting my guys to do things for me, and I didn't yell at them once. And there was a mutual respect there. And let me tell you what, when you're the fourth female on a ship of 396 men, you kind of need a circle around you to get your back. And my guys always had my back because they respected me. So remember my little side note that my high school cutest couple boyfriend is not my husband. The really great thing about being in Norfolk, Virginia, and there's not that many great things about being in Norfolk, Virginia, especially when you went to school in San Diego and had, you know, the beach was my backyard, is that I met my husband. And I still say that was the best part about me being in Virginia. My husband's a Naval Academy graduate. We were married in 2005 at the United States Naval Academy. Had a really great military wedding. We got to walk through the sword arch and everything. And 2 months after we got married, we were lucky enough to spend a 4-year honeymoon in Hawaii. We were both stationed in Pearl Harbor, which was as amazing as you could probably imagine it. And it was really, really a wonderful time for me. There were a lot of firsts in Hawaii and a lot of aha moments, a lot of really positive experiences there. We bought our first home. It was our first married duty station together. I had my first great leader in Hawaii. When I checked into the Commander Destroyer Squadron staff, this man in the white, Captain Fred Furman, who I'm still in touch with, very close to today, he was my boss, my new boss. And he sat down with me in my introduction interview, and he asked me what my plans were for my future in the Navy. And I told him, I'm getting out. My first tour was miserable. My XO just told me that I need to go find a job where they like me for being a nice person. Why would I want to stay here and work for mean people? He took that to heart, and he told me that it was his job to change my mind. And he put his money where his mouth was. He believed in me and provided me so many opportunities to prepare myself for the next phase of my career, even when I wasn't sure that I wanted to make a career out of the Navy. He said over and over and over again, I know you want to get out, but you need to do this just in case. You need to be prepared. I would roll my eyes in my head. I would roll my eyes and smile and say, yes, sir. I asked him over and over again, why me? Why do you want me to stay in? Why do you want me to continue my naval career? And he responded, why not you? You're intelligent and you're capable. And best of all, and this is maybe the best compliment I've ever gotten in my whole life, you have an irrepressibly positive attitude. I thought, wow, that's a really great thing to say. Look at this successful Navy captain commending me for being a kind person and having a positive attitude. He said to me that I was exactly the leader that the Navy needed. And then he said something that I will never, ever forget. He said, "Erin, the young women behind you, the women below you in the Navy, cannot be what they cannot see. If all they've seen is negative leadership, that's all they'll know, and that's what they'll be. You can change that. You have the ability to change that." Wow. That's a pretty profound statement, and a lot of pressure. I was flattered by that and really, really took it to heart, but to be honest, I still wasn't sure. I respected him, so I kept an open mind, and things fell in line, and you know, while I was deployed in the Arabian Gulf in support of OEF on the USS Carl Vinson, it's an aircraft carrier, which is a really, really, really big ship that takes a really long time to figure out how to get around in case you ever go to one. I would recommend it. They're really cool. I worked really hard to qualify as a staff tactical action officer, which was actually two ranks above what I was. And the reason I did that is, again, to be prepared, because I realized that even if I decided not to stay in, what a pretty cool thing to tell people about once I got out in my civilian life that I qualified for this watch station. But the reason I was able to do that is because I had community around to support me. My Navy community, my boss, and the people in my office really, really supported me and were champions of my success. So I was successful. I was able to be successful because I had the resources that I needed and the support that I needed to accomplish these goals for myself. So when the time came that I decided, yes, Captain, you are right, I would really like to stay in. I think I could make a difference here. I was prepared. I submitted my package to become a department head, which is the person in charge of an entire department in the Navy. And I was really lucky that one of the perks to becoming a department head was a 1-year paid sabbatical to get my master's degree. So I had 1 year off in Hawaii to get my master's degree at Hawaii Pacific University in Global Leadership and Sustainable Development. And while I wasn't studying, I was hiking, crazy hikes. That hike is closed, by the way, so if you ever go to Oahu and hear about the Haiku Stairs or the Stairway to Heaven, you might get arrested if you go on it now. The picture on the top right is a view from my condo that I never, ever wanted to leave, but regrettably had to. And I also took up the ukulele while I was there, which was a fun little thing to do. So staying in the Navy diverted my plan. Now I was under the Navy's plan. And I remember going to a meeting for female officers, female surface warfare officers. They had a really hard time trying to get people in my community, the surface warfare community, to stay in, because it's really hard to have a family when you're on a ship out in the middle of the ocean. And the presenter of this meeting had a PowerPoint slide that he, which I thought was ironic, flipped up on the screen, and there were highlighted areas of shore duty, where you work in an office building, where it allowed for family planning. So I printed that off and brought it home to my husband and said, "I know I'm staying in. These are the windows of our life. Here is my next 15 years on a PowerPoint slide, and here's where we can have our kids on this PowerPoint slide." You're all laughing. God laughed in my face. But I was sure that I could do this. I was sure that with the community that I had built and, you know, my love of service and wanting to stay in and praying and praying and having faith that everything would work out. This is us in Hawaii. That was our last summer in Hawaii. It was really beautiful. If you all haven't been to Hawaii, I would recommend going. It's a really, really wonderful, magical place. As I was getting ready to leave Hawaii, I had a really great job as the training liaison officer, where I represented the admiral in charge of all training for the Navy. And my job was to go on board ships with a team of subject matter experts and test, for lack of a better term, test the ship to make sure that they were qualified in all the areas that they needed to be qualified for to be credentialed to deploy. Well, while I was on board one of these ships in Pearl Harbor, who had a reputation for having a captain that was not a very nice man. One of my team members brought up to me that this captain and his ship was in violation of some pretty major security protocols. And I knew that if I brought this up to the captain, he was going to be a really, really angry man. So I have a decision to make. Do I want to bring this up? Do I want to go tell my captain and have my captain go talk to this captain so that I'm out, I don't have to worry about the repercussions of telling him? And I figured, this is my job. This is what my captain sent me here for. I have all of the proof, thanks to my team, my community. So I went to his stateroom and we had a little sit-down meeting. And I no more than said, sir, you're in violation of this specific thing. Here's the proof in this Navy book. He got really, really red-faced and started yelling a lot right in my face and turned around and pushed speakerphone to call my boss. Well, I had already called my boss, so my boss knew exactly what was coming. He answered the phone. Hello, hello. Lots of screaming. You will not believe what Lieutenant Johnson is sitting here telling me. I'm in violation of XYZ. And my boss said, well, actually, I do believe it. She showed me, and you are in violation. So she's right. You're wrong. Have a nice day. Click. And I just sat there with a smile on my face, waiting for more screaming. And he took a deep breath, and he hung his head because he knew that we were telling the truth and that you can't argue with the truth. But the only way I could have made that decision was with the support of my team. Again, it's one of these situations where in my team, I work to establish mutual respect, and I respected them and their subject matter expertise, and they respected me as a leader to take that up to the chain of command to get it resolved. So I talked a little bit about living in Hawaii. Clearly, it wasn't all work. There was a lot of play. It was a really, really wonderful place and a really great place for my husband and I to start off our marriage. The not so great thing about Hawaii was how our stay in Hawaii ended, which brings me to part two of my life, the after cancer. My husband, the summer of 2009, took a 1-year unaccompanied, meaning without me, job to be stationed in the Middle East. He was living in Bahrain, working for the Navy's Central Command there. I was finishing up my master's degree. I had just shipped my car and all of my stuff to the East Coast to start my department head training, and went to the doctor because I had felt a lump and learned that I had cancer. So staying at my friend's house in their guest bedroom. Now, there's never really a good time to find out when you're 29 years old that you completely out of the blue unexpectedly have cancer. But when your husband is halfway across the world and your car is on its way and all of your stuff is on its way to the East Coast for you to start the next chapter of your life, and you're staying with friends in their guest bedroom, it is a particularly awful time to find out you have cancer. Definitely the biggest aw shucks moment of my life. But I had a community, and they sure did rally. My diagnosis went from, we think this is minor, it's a relatively small lump, we can remove the lump, you can have some radiation, you'll be postponed to department head school for a couple of months, but you'll get through your treatment and you'll be okay. So I scheduled my lumpectomy for September 11th, and I'll never forget that day. It was awkward. They asked me if it was okay to have surgery on September 11th. I mean, I know bad things happen on September 11th, but yes, please, let's do this. I just want to get it over with and done. The Navy flew my husband home to Hawaii to be with me for that, which I was very, very grateful for. And the night before my surgery, I'm going to stop there. I feel like I've done a pretty good job up until this point, from diagnosis to the night before my surgery, so 10 days-ish, holding it all together. I'm a facts person. The minute I was diagnosed, I just started reading everything I could on breast cancer and prognoses and treatment protocol and all of these things, arming myself with as much fact as I could so that I could make educated decisions about my health and about my future. So, again, I had a plan. I was going to remove the lump, wait for a little while for healing, have some radiation, get on with my life. Great. So 2 days before my surgery, I got a call and found out that I tested positive for the BRCA1 genetic mutation, which I had never heard of before. Didn't even know to ask to get tested. Luckily, my medical team was really smart and tested me. It's a genetic mutation that has an 87% lifetime risk of breast cancer and a really high risk also for ovarian cancer. So that was a surprise, but still, didn't change my plans, didn't change my treatment plan. And then the next night, the night before my surgery, I'm getting ready for bed because I have to be at the hospital at 5 o'clock in the morning to check into nuclear medicine. Doesn't that sound reassuring? to check into nuclear medicine, and the surgeon called and had told me that my MRI results were back, and unfortunately, the tumor was invading my chest wall and my surgery was canceled because they weren't sure that they could safely operate. That was the first time I cried. and the worst part of that was that my mom was still in Seattle, and I had to call her, it was midnight her time, and tell her that my surgery was canceled, my tumor was essentially inoperable at this point, and we're going to plan B. So I got a call from my doctor the next morning. They discussed my case at the tumor board, and their decision was that I would need chemo, a lot of chemo, to help shrink the tumor so that they could operate successfully, hopefully operate successfully. So my husband, who you know is supposed to be living in the, has an apartment really in the Middle East at this point because he's supposed to be living there for a year, flies back to the Middle East in the hopes that he can get out of those orders and get back to me before I have to start my chemo. He didn't. Unfortunately, he missed my first round, but he was there for all the rest of them. And the Navy flew me to Seattle so that I could be close to my family during my treatment. The picture on the top right is my family meeting me. My mom flew with me, but my family meeting me at the airport, and this is only just my immediate family, but when I got out of that, when I exited the gate, literally I had 30 people there with pink balloons and roses and t-shirts that said, Erin's support crew, clapping for me and welcoming me with open arms. You know, you want to talk about a community, like what an awesome, awesome welcome. The picture below is myself and my favorite chemo nurse, Judy. That is actually me receiving my first round of chemo. And Judy was really, really instrumental. And she was my nurse all through chemo. I always had her every Wednesday when I went. And I built a really, really great relationship with her. I'm still in touch with her today, and she was so supportive of me, and she was really, really wonderful. And then there's me and my husband. That was my second round of chemo. He missed my first round of chemo. He didn't make it back in time, but like I said, he was there for all the rest of them. So when I was diagnosed, my sister was, she's very, very emotional. And she was crying on the phone to me, and I was trying to console her, telling her that everything was going to be okay. And her question to me was, well, why you? I don't understand. You're healthy, and you're young, and you're active, and you take such good care of yourself. And my question back to her was, why not me? You know, if one in eight women are going to get breast cancer, and I'm one of more than eight women in my family, but I felt of those eight women, I didn't have children. I had a wonderful job, a wonderful supportive community, wonderful, wonderful insurance. I was really kind of in the best position to go through it of all the other women in my family. So why not? You know, why not me? If it's going to be any one of us, why not me? And again, one of the reasons that I got through all of it as I don't want to say easily because it wasn't easy, but as well as I did was because of my community. These are the requisite head shaving pictures. So there's bald me. That was interesting. It was really funny. I never cared so much about losing my hair. I was never a person that was really attached to my hair, as you can see through all of these pictures. I was joking earlier that I could call this presentation the evolution of horrible hairstyles. So I didn't mind losing my hair, but when they tell you that all of your hair falls out, you forget that your eyelashes and eyebrows are hair. And when I lost my eyebrows and eyelashes, that was a really, really hard thing to get through because people just don't look very well with no eyebrows and eyelashes. When I was going through my treatment, there were times where I was fearful. There were times where I was really, really, really angry. I prayed a lot. And You know, even though I told my sister, why not me? I asked God all the time, why me? Why did you choose me to go through all of this? And, you know, I was really angry, honestly. I felt like I had done everything right in life. I never smoked. I was healthy. I drank organic milk in college, which was a really long time ago before organic milk was like the trendy thing to drink. So I didn't understand why this would happen to me. And it would really bother me when people would tell me, you know, everything's going to be okay. God has a plan for you. And my internal response was, I don't understand how this is part of God's plan. I cannot comprehend how me going through 18 rounds of chemo and 9 surgeries and a summer full of radiation and ending my Navy career could possibly be part of God's plan. And my favorite nurse, Judy, I showed you her picture, she told me something. It was one of my first rounds of chemo, and I was telling her that I was really angry, and I didn't like it when people said that God had a plan for me because I just didn't understand what this plan could possibly be. She said, you know, Erin, good things come from bad things. And I loved that. And I say it's kind of my mantra now, honestly. I say it all the time. There's going to be a lot of bad things that are going to happen in each of your lives. It's just the way life is. I mean, there's going to be a lot of good things, but there will also be a lot of bad things. And, you know, you talk about silver lining. Good things do come from bad things. Yes, I had cancer. Yes, I was bald and had a lot of surgeries. And that bottom picture is me getting radiation. That's what getting radiation looks like. But I have a wonderful community of women that I never, ever would have met before. My very best friend is a breast cancer survivor, and I never would have met her had I not gone through this. I wouldn't be standing here today had I not gone through this. So it was awful, but here I am, loving where I am, and am living proof that good things do come from bad things. So I finished treatment. It took almost a year. I was diagnosed September 1st, 2009, and finished radiation August 12th of 2010. And my husband, who was home for all of my treatment, deployed 2 weeks later for 8 months. So I'm done with treatment. I am, you know, left like Humpty Dumpty to pick up all the pieces and try to put myself back together again. And my best friend and husband and champion is gone. And that was really, really, really hard. And I knew that in order to get through it like a sane person, I needed a new community. So I found a breast cancer support group specifically for young women with breast cancer in Seattle. And they became my best friends. You know, and when I was in the Navy, I was surrounded by men, so all of my friends were dudes. Nothing wrong with having guy friends. I still have a lot of guy friends. But I'd never really had close girlfriends since high school. And now I had 50 of them who had all been through the same experience as me. It was really, really empowering to be surrounded by other women who shared my experience and who we had a common bond with. The hardest thing, maybe, of the aftermath of going through all of my breast cancer recovery was facing a medical retirement. Because of all my surgeries and because the type of breast cancer that I had was so aggressive, I could no longer be on ships, meaning I could no longer be a department head. I couldn't do the work that I was trained to do in the Navy. I couldn't deploy. I was a non-deployable asset in naval terms. And I was medically retired. And that was devastating. You know, here I went from the beginning of my Navy career where it was miserable and I was getting out because it was just not right for me to moving to Hawaii, working for wonderful leaders who supported me, building my Navy community there, wanting to stay in to set an example, and then being told, sorry, you can't. Your career is over. Your Navy career is over. That was a really, really hard decision for me. A decision that was out of my hands, really. So, I didn't really know how to move past that, to be honest. My husband came back from a second deployment in 18 months in March of 2012, right, April of 2012, right after I was medically retired. And as soon as he got back, we packed up and moved across the country to Washington, D.C. So for the first time in our married life, we were moving together and not for both of our jobs. I had no job. I was leaving all my family, all my friends, my whole medical doctor support team, my breast cancer community, and moving across the country for my husband's orders at the Joint Chiefs of Staff at the Pentagon. I was miserable, miserable. I was miserable the entire drive across the country, and we went to some really cool places, but I was like, you know, arms crossed, looking out the window the whole time. I did not have a good attitude about it at all, so much for my irrepressibly positive attitude. I was very angry and very bitter and miserable, and I had no idea what I wanted to do once I got to Washington, D.C. No idea. I knew I didn't want to be a doctor. I knew I didn't want to be a lawyer. I knew I didn't want to be an accountant. I don't really like numbers that much. But I knew I had to figure it out. The hardest part was I felt like I had to figure it out by myself because I didn't have a community where I was going. So after pouting for a few weeks and after getting unpacked and everything, I realized that I needed a community. So I got involved with the local breast cancer community there. I got involved with some networking groups and started making friends and started building, again, rebuilding my community in Washington, D.C. One of the things that I found as an outlet was exercising again and going through all the treatment that I did, getting back into working out and exercising was a big challenge, and it took me a long time to get back to distance running. But I did, and I started running half marathons, doing distance bike rides, centuries, those kinds of things to raise money for breast cancer support and awareness. So that's my first post-cancer half marathon. And then the bottom picture is after I finished my first century bike ride and then a mud run, which I didn't want to do, but when your boss calls you at 6 o'clock Friday evening and said, what are you doing at 6 o'clock tomorrow morning? And you say, I'm sleeping. And he says, wrong answer, you're doing a mud run with our staff. Then you nod your head and say, yes, sir, I'll be there. I didn't enjoy it at all. For all the people who love mud running, no thank you. I like clean running a lot better than muddy running. So still no idea what I want to do as a career. I assumed, because I was a senior lieutenant getting out of the Navy with my experience and my degree, my top secret security clearance, that I would be a defense contractor. That's what a lot of people my age getting out did. And DC is a kind of a haven for defense contracting, to be honest. So I went on several interviews. They did not go well, and I realized very quickly that defense contracting was not what I wanted to do, and after everything that I had been through in my life, I really needed to continue serving, continue my service, and find a job in the nonprofit sector to be able to allow me to do that. American Society of Clinical Oncology was a mile away from my home in Alexandria, and I thought, what a noble cause. You know, I'm a cancer survivor, I will be a champion for them, I want to work for them. Well, of course, you can't really write on your resume, I'm a cancer survivor, so I will be a good advocate for you. And all I had on my resume was military experience, and I really didn't know how to convey my military experience to civilian terminology so that it would apply to an organization like American Society of Clinical Oncology. So I applied for probably 4 or 5 jobs there, didn't get a single call back, was really discouraged, and I found a job opening at the USO. I had no idea, to be honest, what the job even was. It was a senior manager for development. I had no clue what that was, but I thought, the USO, it's military, I was in the military, I'm a perfect fit for this job. They didn't call me back. A couple of weeks later, I saw another job for the USO. It was as a programs manager. Well, I managed a lot of programs in the Navy, and it was for wounded, ill, and injured military members. I was a wounded, ill, or injured military member. Perfect. So I was on the computer updating my cover letter and got a phone call, and it was the USO HR department, and they called me and said, you applied for this job a couple weeks ago, and you were not qualified for this job, but we were very impressed with your resume, and we have this other job as a programs manager, and we want you to come interview for it. Are you interested? And my response was, well, as a matter of fact, I am. I got that job, and the actual job description was to help build out education programs for wounded, ill, and injured military members and Gold Star families, meaning families who have lost loved ones as a casualty of war. And it was so fulfilling. That job was so fulfilling. I loved it. I loved being able to work directly with these wounded, ill, and injured military members and giving them a chance to succeed past their injury as they transitioned into the civilian world. It was one absolutely exactly what I wanted to be doing. One of the other things that I did was volunteer for everything. We had a pretty big department, and every programs manager managed several different programs. Some of the programs managers got to manage really cool programs like the New York Experience and Jon Stewart Daily Show visit. I didn't have that cool, like, we didn't get to do that cool stuff. I mean, still really fulfilling, but not that cool. But I volunteered for everything. I volunteered to do inventory at a unconditioned warehouse in Georgia in June, which was really awful, but I volunteered to do it. I volunteered to do a lot of really unsexy jobs so that when the cool jobs, like stuffing Mother's Day packages for deployed soldiers to mail to their mother on the lawn of the vice president's house right by his pool with Dr. Biden, I was chosen to do that because I volunteered for everything. You know, when my colleague who managed the Jon Stewart New York Experience tour program was getting married and was on her honeymoon when there was a tour going on, she asked me if I would be willing to take her group to New York and go watch this Jon Stewart show. Well, heck yeah, I'm willing to do that. But I got those opportunities because of my sense of service, because I took that job to heart and I wanted to serve the people around me and serve the troops as much as I could. So it afforded me a lot of really great opportunities. While I was at the USO, one of our best-in-class program partners was Hire Heroes USA. Hire Heroes USA was the employment service provider for employment transition programs. So this is an organization, we are an organization that helps, all we do is help military members and veterans transition to civilian employment and spouses, military spouses. I worked pretty closely with our USO partner, our USO Hire Heroes USA partnership, and at a meeting, the CEO of Hire Heroes USA was there as I was presenting and was really impressed with me. And he pulled me aside at the end of that meeting and said, "I don't know what your situation is, but I'm building out my marketing and communications department, and I would really love for you to come work for me." Well, the office, their headquarters is in Georgia, in Alpharetta, Georgia. And I smiled at him and I said, "Well, thanks, but first of all, I love it here at the USO. And second of all, my husband's at the Pentagon and I would really love to live with him if I could. And there's no ocean in Alpharetta, Georgia where there's Navy ships, so I can't go there." He said, "Oh, I'll let you work remotely. You can go wherever it is that your husband's stationed." And I said, "Wow, that's pretty perfect gig for a military spouse." So I took it. It's one of those situations again where I was prepared, and I had the support of my community, and I was able to land this dream job. Really, this is just backtracking. I'm a little bit behind this. So this is a picture of the Daily Show set. I couldn't take pictures of Jon Stewart while he was actually talking. So Hire Heroes USA. What do we do? We empower transitioning military members, unemployed and underemployed veterans, and military spouses to succeed in the civilian workforce. We started really actively in 2007. Since then, we've conducted 220,000 plus career counselings. We've revised more than 34,000 resumes. We've accounted for 15,000 confirmed hires. So 15,000 unemployed veterans and military spouses now have jobs after working with us, and have an estimated $180 million economic impact because of those 15,000 veterans hired. This job means everything to me. In my introduction, it was mentioned that I struggled with my transition, and I spoke a little bit about that. My transition was a challenge. You know, I didn't want to transition. I didn't want to get out of the Navy. I was forced out, and I had no idea, even as educated as I was and with all the experience that I had, the thought of leaving the Navy and leaving my community and leaving those, you know, just everything that I thought I would do was really, really, really hard. I really struggled. And I know I'm not alone. There are plenty of people who have a lot more issues and a lot more barriers to employment than I ever did, who struggle as well. You know, people in the military, infantrymen or tank driver, well, how does that convey to a civilian job? I mean, you know, if you're driving a tank in the military, how are you going to write a resume to get a job as an IT specialist? And these are the types of people that we work with every day. Our client base is 80% enlisted, so 80% junior military members who enlist right out of high school, they're between 18 and 24 years old, that raise their hand and volunteer to defend our nation. And my boss and myself and everybody else in our organization feels like they deserve our very best. You know, it's, why wouldn't we help empower them to get a job to succeed in the civilian world? It's really, we see it as our duty to help them succeed in the civilian world. And the best way to help them succeed is to help them take care of themselves. You know, without a job and without a paycheck, it's hard to provide for themselves and their families, and it becomes an emotional issue, an emotional spiral, and they have all kinds of problems, emotional problems, mental issues. And studies have shown that that a very, very, very small percentage of transitioning military members who come out with a job have ended their life. So what we're doing is meaningful, it's impactful, and it makes a huge, huge difference. And I can personally attest to that. I would have loved to have known about Hire Heroes USA when I was transitioning out of the military. I didn't know that they existed, but I probably wouldn't have spent almost a year unemployed had I known. So with Hire Heroes and the USO, I've gotten to do some pretty cool things. Like I said, I volunteered for everything. So there's me with Grover on a Sesame Street function. The bottom right picture, again, is me at the White House. So I share my story about breast cancer very frequently. I feel like I'm an advocate for young women with breast cancer. I feel like it's my duty as a survivor to educate people so that they know that young women can and do get breast cancer, and that we're thrivers and survivors, and we can come away from stage 3B invasive ductal carcinoma and 18 rounds of chemo and be healthy. So I talk about it very openly. And I was last summer at a function of one of our corporate partners, WWE, and we were at a corporate partner dinner, and I was speaking with a woman there who was the vice president of their community relations team, and she asked how I got my job at Hire Heroes. So I told her about my whole history and being medically retired from the Navy because I'm a breast cancer survivor, and 2 months later, she calls me on the telephone and says, "You're a military member and a cancer survivor, and I have an opportunity for you to speak to the vice president about your experiences." And I said, "The vice president of WWE?" She said, "No, the vice president of the United States." Oh, wow. Yes, I will do that. So here I am at the big table. You know, I walk into the room and I see all these name tags around the table, and I instantly walk to the back of the room where all the additional chairs and additional seats are, and my boss, Brian Stanton, who's sitting next to me, he points to my name tag and says, "You're up here at the big kids table." And there I was, just a few seats down from the vice president, and sat there for 2 hours. This was just moments after he and President Obama signed the Cancer Moonshot Initiative to help increase research and funding for military members and first responders with that have cancer and medical issues. And this was our roundtable discussion. I'm still active in this roundtable group. On the other side of me now, sitting across the table from me, who's not in this picture, is now the Secretary of the VA. So I speak with them frequently. They ask for my opinion. They ask for my experience. And I'm now a trusted resource of the Secretary of the VA because I shared my story, because I embraced my community and shared my story. I was given this opportunity. So you heard a little bit about my history, and you probably realize that I have no development experience. I, like I said, didn't know what development was when I applied for the USO development job. I'd never heard of development. And if you had told me 5 years ago when I got out of the Navy that I would be standing here talking to all of you as the director of development for a nonprofit, I would have said development. Am I developing commercial real estate or residential real estate? I honestly had no idea what development did. And I don't have a degree in development. I don't have a background in fundraising. Really, development is all about communication and developing relationships. As a nonprofit, we depend on donors to fund us so that we can provide our services to the military members and our clients for free. We don't charge them a penny for any of our transition services. So I go around the country talking to funders, potential funders, sharing my story, sharing the story about us and what we do and our impact, in hopes that I'm providing them a compelling avenue to support the military through our organization. When my boss offered me this promotion and offered me this role, my question to him was, why me? There it is again, why me? I don't have any development experience, Brian. I don't know if I can do this. And he said, you absolutely can do this. With your positive attitude, you can do, I know you can do anything. And so far, so good. We grew as an organization. We doubled in size in 2015, which meant that when I took over as the director of development, I was responsible for a 42% budget increase. So 42% additional funds that I have to gather for our organization in order for our staff members to get paid and for us to continue serving veterans. There's a little bit of pressure. No problem, right? Of course I can. Of course I can do this. And I did. You know, it took a lot of hard work. It took me surrounding myself with really competent people and, again, building that servant leadership, that mutual respect between them and me, so that we would work together as a team to accomplish a huge goal, and we were able to do it. And I'm really, really grateful to be where I am. I'm grateful for the opportunity to be in the position that I am. I'm grateful for the opportunity to share my story with all of you. And I would never be here without community support. I would never be here without lots of different support circles around me that have shaped my upbringing and shaped me being here today. So I'm not where I had imagined I'd be. And that's okay, right? I mean, when I was a junior in high school, I thought I was going to be a physical therapist and spend some time in the Navy and get married to my high school sweetheart, cutest couple, and have, you know, 2.5 kids and a dog and a white picket fence and live right down the road from my mom and dad and my sister, and everything would be awesome. I live all the way across the country from my family. I miss them like crazy every day, but it's okay because I built my own family in DC. I have a wonderful sense of community there. And I really, I mean, besides the humidity, really love where I live. You know, in that process, I've learned a lot about myself. I learned that I'm much more interested in political science than I in public administration than I am in physics and rehabilitation. I'm, like I said, I'm not very good at math, which is kind of ironic since I'm now a career fundraiser. I learned that my high school sweetheart wasn't the person that I wanted to grow old with, and again, that's okay. I learned that a life-threatening illness can affect anyone, and how it affects you and how you deal with those changes not only shapes your own life, but shapes the lives of the people around you. And in order to get through something like that, something as traumatic as that, you need a community. So in each success of my life, they're all directly related to this school's founding tenets. Worship. Worship is a pretty personal thing. Some people like to, you know, they like to worship in church in a big group of people. I at one point really liked to do that. After cancer, I like to worship, you know, with a pair of running shoes on an open road, just talking to God, just over and over. Why me? Why am I going through this? What's going on? What is your plan? Show me your way. I'm lost. I need direction. So whatever it is, I would encourage you to find something that works best for you and make that a part of your daily routine. I talked a lot about community. I feel like it's my favorite word today. Who's in your corner? Who do you have around you to support your aw shucks moments, but more importantly, to celebrate your achievements? Who's there for you? I would encourage you to build circles as big as you can because you need them. When life goes up in flames, you definitely need a community around you. Service. I have a little bit of an interesting definition of service, I think. How can you help those around you be the best version of themselves? When I was in the Navy, I have a really strong sense of service. I feel like it's my duty to serve others. I feel like it's my duty to share the blessings that I've been bestowed in my life and help others succeed. That's something that's very, very, very important to me. And remember, like my boss said, those around you cannot be what they cannot see. So make it your mission to open their eyes. How can you help them? How can you help them be the best version of themselves? Ethical decision making. This kind of ties it all together, right? It's a lot easier to make the right decision when your heart and mind are clear and you have a support team around you. When I went up to that captain, I knew he was going to be angry, but I knew I had a whole community around me that had my back because we worked together and we built that mutual respect. So, in conclusion, change is going to happen. It's inevitable, right? Embrace it. Trust that throughout your life you've prepared yourself to get through that change, whatever it may be, good or bad. You've surrounded yourself with a wonderful, strong community so that you can maximize the opportunity that change presents. And remember, I heard this quote yesterday, actually. Val Nicholas, who's a vice president of NBC, he was sitting on a panel, a WWE panel that I was part of, and he said this quote, and I thought it was perfect for this. Nobody gets anywhere on their own. Nobody. Every one of you has had help along the way, and you'll continue to need help through the rest of your life, and hopefully you will be that help to another person. Who has questions? Any questions? Cancer, Navy, life in general, meeting Mark Henry, WWE superstar who's a little bit larger than me. I'm happy to answer any questions. Sure, absolutely. I don't know what you all probably didn't hear. Mr. O asked if I could, I had dinner with him last night, and when I mentioned, I was the fourth female on my ship and shared some experiences around that. So one of the ways that I dealt with that situation was that I made a decision that I would avoid at all cost putting myself in situations that could potentially go bad. The Navy's pretty notorious for crazy sailors pulling into ports and going crazy, and I didn't. I went out and I had fun, but I did not drink because I never wanted to be in a situation where I wasn't in control, I wasn't aware of my surroundings. I didn't want to set myself up for failure. But also, I wanted to be able to be completely cognizant and able to help any of my sailors that got themselves into trouble. And I knew I couldn't do that if I was impaired. So, being one of very few females in a very male-dominated profession it's a privilege, honestly. It's a privilege to be one of the guys. And to be kind of seen as one of the guys, but it's also really important to establish boundaries and make sure that you're taking care of yourself and that you're not putting yourself in situations that could go, potentially could go wrong. Because if you're not in those situations, then you don't have to worry about it.